Welcome to Surviving Schizophrenia. My name is Stephen. I hope you're having a wonderful day. So I've had significant sleep dysregulation since I fell ill with schizophrenia over 10 years ago. Sleep disturbances are very common in schizophrenia, and the rate is estimated to be between 30 and 80%. I'd like to talk to you about the sleep disturbances I'm experiencing. But first, let's talk about sleep dysregulation in schizophrenia. Schizophrenia is a chronic and severe mental disorder affecting millions of people worldwide, characterized by disordered thoughts, hallucinations, and social withdrawal. It severely impacts people's lives, disrupting their functionality and interpersonal relationships. But beyond these commonly known symptoms, lies a lesser known, but highly prevalent feature of schizophrenia, sleep dysregulation. Let's dive into the connection between sleep disturbances and schizophrenia, the clinical implications, and potential therapeutic approaches. Understanding sleep dysregulation in schizophrenia. Common sleep issues among individuals with schizophrenia include insomnia and delayed sleep phase syndrome, amongst others. People living with schizophrenia, like me, often report difficulties falling asleep, maintaining sleep, or having non-restful sleep. These sleep disturbances can exacerbate the severity of symptoms and have been linked to a worse prognosis, poor quality of life, and increased risk of relapse. Personally, yeah, I have pretty much all of that. I have a lot of difficulties when I'm trying to go to sleep at night. And when I finally do fall asleep, usually half an hour later when I'm in bed. Yeah, I don't really have a good maintained sleep there. And I'm usually not very well rested throughout the night. And I mean, some of this, I think I know why, and I'll explain that right now. I do eat too much at night. I know that. So I'll usually have dinner around 5:30, which is kind of early, but I get really hungry because I'm on medication. So by 5, I'm really hungry. And so I eat dinner then. Maybe an hour or two later, I'll have dessert. Usually ice cream, like a bowl of ice cream or a drumstick, something like that. Maybe some chocolate. But not too much. However, the issue comes at about 8 o'clock. Now I take my meds around 8 o'clock. And that's when I get really hungry and I start to snack, which is not good if you're trying to fall asleep soon after. And I try to eat relatively healthy snacks, like I'll eat bowls of Cheerios, or sometimes I'll throw a few mini wheats in there. I don't know if anyone else does this, but Cheerios and mini wheats go really well together, I think. But I'll try to eat healthier stuff like that, you know, like crackers, goldfish, stuff that isn't full of tons of sugar and or high in protein usually. Well, let's say I do eat peanuts as well sometimes at night. No, that's really great, you know. If you're going to be going to sleep, you should be trying to cut out food, right? So your body's not digesting it while you're sleeping because it keeps you awake. That's, I know, an issue that I face while trying to sleep. That I'm kind of full when I'm trying to go to sleep, which isn't good. Working on that still, it's not easy because the medication side effects that do make me so hungry, but I'm working on that. And the other thing comes with my medication. Usually about by 9 or 10 o'clock or so, I am wiped out from my medication. It hits me sometimes pretty quickly too. And all of a sudden, like I could have been fine a couple minutes before, falling asleep, and then I go like that, and I realize, shoot, I am tired. I've got to go to sleep. Sometimes my parents have to help spot me up the stairs to go to my bed. But that doesn't mean I'm tired in the right way, which is weird, because I feel tired, but I'm not tired in the right way to sleep, I think, my understanding. And so I might be tired, but I'm not ready for bed when I go to bed, usually. So I kind of toss and turn, like I said earlier, you know, I don't get to bed right away, or to sleep right away while I'm in bed. and just get kind of a restless night of sleep, which isn't good either. And I wake up usually around 10:30 in the morning. I try to wake up before my alarm because I absolutely hate waking up to the alarm. And I'm usually feeling very tired still. What I usually do in the morning is around 10:30 whenever I wake up, I'll listen to some music on my phone and wake up that way. I find that helps me. And then after that, I will brush my teeth, do my morning routine like that, come on downstairs, have some breakfast, bowl of cereal, and a cup of coffee. And by that point, I'm about as awake as I'll get with the coffee. That helps a lot too. So that's kind of my routine at night and in the morning. But again, I'm never, almost ever rather, feeling well rested when I wake up in the morning. So let me tell you about my sleep, you know, whether I have dreams and nightmares, whether I'm waking up in the middle of the night to use the restroom or sweating profusely and not able to sleep, or having to get up to get water or anything like that. And so I have most of that, actually. I'll usually wake up 2 times a night, sometimes more, to use the restroom. I think that's also more of a stress thing as opposed to a thing about needing to use the restroom. I remember when I fell ill early on, I'd use the bathroom more than I had to. Not because I needed to, but because I was so stressed out, I felt like it, if that makes sense. Remember at school, I'd be, it's a tangent here, but I'd always be using the bathroom and they'd be worried about me, or like, am I trying to get out of class or something, maybe. No, I just feel like I need to because that's like a stress response, and I have that at night too. I do have nightmares sometimes, but most of the time it's just regular dreams that I have that are just keeping me awake. I don't know. Sometimes I'm biking, like way down, walking. I don't bike actually anymore, but in the dreams I do sometimes, I'll bike like down to Redondo Beach from my house, which is a long ways away for bike. And then I'll have to come back, and usually I can't get back for some reason, and something, I don't know, weird dreams. But I definitely have dreams at night, and I'm sure that's affecting my sleep a bit too, because I'm not really resting when those are happening. And one of the other biggest issues I face with my sleep is that, well, I think it's part of the medication, maybe it's part of the schizophrenia too, but well, it's actually two things. One is that I can't regulate my body heat well. So I tend to sweat a lot at night, and that's really not good because I'm not sleeping well then, just like overheating constantly. It's been hotter lately, in the summer right now, so that doesn't help either. And when it's a lot of heat, I really don't do well, and I really don't sleep well. But even if it's like a cool night, sometimes I still overheat anyway. I also tend to drool a lot. That's definitely a side effect of the medication. Yeah, I don't quite know exactly why that is, but I know it's a side effect, and I have 2 pillows for that reason, and that does affect me a bit too, but I've gotten used to that part. I take clozapine, and that's the medication I was talking about that causes me to have excess salivation, not just at night, but even during the day. However, it's really more of an issue at night when I'm trying to sleep than it is during the day. I have, as far as I know at least, no problems breathing at night, however. I do have an appliance that I wear at night. That's because I have TMJ, my jaw is, I don't know, for lack of a better word, kind of messed up, I guess. It has locked in me in the past and still pops a lot. So I have an appliance at night to keep it in check so it won't lock at night. And also I can't grind my teeth with that, so that's good. That means I'm not grinding my teeth at night. That would keep me up as well. It is kind of annoying to have 2 giant appliances. Well, it's like a regular size retainer on the bottom, but a giant appliance on top. However, it's better than the alternative of having my jaw lock at night, which was happening before, which is not good. So that part's better. As far as, and that doesn't affect my breathing, actually, at all. So that's not really an issue. As far as nightmares go, I don't have them very often. I think my dreams tend to be more intense anyway. Like what I said with biking, you know, I'm doing something in these dreams, like running, biking, moving, always doing something. Which might be because my mind's always racing and doing something, actually. That I don't know if that might be correlated there actually. When I do have nightmares, I mean, again, it's not as common. Everyone gets nightmares anyway, but I tend to dream of war because that's something that scares the heck out of me. I don't have more to say there. That's just a terrifying fear of mine that comes out sometimes at night with a nightmare of war. And that is like one of the most terrifying things to me. Other than that, my dreams usually are, like I said, more intense, but not nightmares usually at all. Those are few and far between when they happen. Yeah. And then that's not like all night nightmares either. I think I tend to have multiple dreams a night anyway, so it's not like it's always war all night. It's like maybe that happens, but then also I'll be, again, doing something else, hiking or climbing or swimming or doing something active. It's kind of interesting because I don't do a lot of active stuff in my real life, but when I'm at night, I do for some reason in my dreams. Focusing back on the research side of things when it comes to sleep disturbances, it's also been observed that people with schizophrenia often exhibit abnormal sleep architecture. Sleep architecture refers to the structure and pattern of sleep cycles, including the stages of non-REM sleep and REM sleep. In people with schizophrenia, there may be a reduction in slow wave deep sleep stage, increased sleep onset latency, the time taken to transition from full wakefulness to sleep, and shortened REM sleep latency, the time from the onset of sleep to the first REM period. There's also the role of the circadian rhythm. The circadian rhythm, our internal biological clock that regulates the sleep-wake cycle, is frequently disturbed in individuals with schizophrenia. There's increased evidence linking circadian rhythm disruption with schizophrenia. This can lead to a fragmented and irregular sleep-wake patterns, further contributing to the sleep disturbances seen in schizophrenia. This brings us to implications for treatment. Recognizing and treating sleep dysregulation in schizophrenia is crucial not only to improving sleep quality, but also to enhance overall therapeutic outcomes. Addressing sleep disturbances can alleviate some schizophrenia symptoms and improve cognitive function and quality of life. Cognitive behavioral therapy for insomnia has shown effectiveness in treating sleep disorders in the general population and could be adapted for those with schizophrenia. It includes strategies such as sleep hygiene education, cognitive therapy, and relaxation techniques. Moreover, research suggests that targeting the circadian rhythm through interventions like bright light therapy or melatonin supplementation may be beneficial. Additionally, while antipsychotic medication is the mainstay of schizophrenia treatment, their effect on sleep can be a double-edged sword. Some antipsychotics can improve sleep continuity and increase total sleep time, while others may lead to sleep disturbances like sleep apnea or restless leg syndrome. Therefore, the choice of antipsychotic medication should take into account the individual's sleep pattern. So in conclusion, sleep dysregulation in schizophrenia is a significant yet often overlooked aspect of this complex disorder. It is something that I've been working on improving really since I fell ill, and I think I've done a good job of that. I've been trying to exercise as often as possible, which definitely helps my sleep when I do. Eat less before I go to sleep. And I talk to my psychiatrist and my parents about it too. You know, if I'm not having good sleep for a while, that can really affect my mental health. And when that's happening, I talk to my parents or my psychiatrist, and we try to figure out what's causing it and how to fix it at the time. And in general, just also I've noticed I should try to go to bed when I am tired enough, because I notice when I don't and I stay up too late, I kind of miss my chance to get a good night's sleep, and all of a sudden I'm even more tired, but too awake at the same time to go to sleep. So that's the other thing I've noticed. I try to go to sleep when I am tired enough to as well. So it's a daily, or rather a nightly, struggle, but it's something I'm working on nonetheless. Because having a good night's sleep is so important in staying mentally healthy, and also staying as healthy as I can with schizophrenia. And it's just so important, and I know that I'm gonna continue working on it as I move forward. I hope you all enjoyed this video and maybe learned something too. And I hope you have a happy and healthy rest of your day. And I hope to see you in the next video. Bye.